The open world games trend certainly isn't going away because 2020 had many solid games that also just happened to feature large explorable worlds. Now every year, we take a look back at the end of the year and round up the best open world games. So here are 10 of the best open world games released throughout 2020. Starting off at number 10, let's talk Mafia Definitive Edition. This game takes you, the protagonist Tommy Angelo, and drops you into the fictional city of Lost Heaven, Illinois, which was loosely based on Chicago, and man, do they do a good job with this. Just the way the city looks, this 1930s Great Depression, Prohibition type thing, where culture is rapidly evolving and organized crime runs rampant. The districts here are really the most interesting thing for me personally. You have like the downtown area with the elevated trains, the tall buildings, the glitz and glam, the neon lights. Then you go over to more factory style areas, there's suburbs, there's a lot to experience here. Although I will admit a lot of it is just sightseeing since this is based on the original Mafia classic game. There's not a ton of like open world side quest shenanigans here. Mostly it's a straightforward single player narrative. There's no BS out in that open world. It's just set dressing, but it's still fun to explore just because of the tone and atmosphere and just the general look of the buildings, the architecture, all of that. It's just really cool because we don't get open world games like this that often. So yeah, there's not a ton of things to collect or random side missions or anything like that, but the world they built here is commendable and still we think is worth experiencing. Next over at number 9, we have Mount & Blade 2 Bannerlord, which if there's one game on the list we're kind of making an exception for, it's this one. It's like sort of open world sandboxy. Yes, some of it is separated by load screens, but then you have the main overworld map, which you can plan your conquests and all that. This game is more than you would think. There are RPG elements to it, and you can explore open environments and go about more of an RPG style thing. You can talk to NPCs, you can build relationships, you can engage in the local economy with shops and stuff like that, which the developers did spend a lot of time on. You ride around on horseback or you go on foot, and this is of course all while you build your army and conquer and fight and engage in the world of Calradia. Now the main name of the game of course still is the large scale massive battles and all the strategy and stuff like that, but we thought pointing out the open world elements were important, especially considering the fact that this game is still ongoing, the developers are still very much working on it. When we first took a look at it, it was technically in early access, and of course modders are also going wild with this. This is definitely a PC gamer's game, so it is very much for a specific type of player. Don't expect like open world Skyrim with Dynasty Warrior battles or something like that. It's way deeper than that, but it's worth checking out, like I said, because it's a PC gamer's game, or maybe a PC gamer's dad's game at this point. Next over at number 8, we have Yakuza Like a Dragon, which takes place in Yokohama. And like any good Yakuza game worth its salt, it takes place in a seedy red light district. And once again, they nail it here. We've been advocating for these games forever, and they are worth experiencing specifically because when you're not beating people up in the streets, you're experiencing this world, and they always go for more of a quality over quantity type thing. The cities aren't massive in these games, and definitely not here. You're not driving around in a car going wherever you want. You are on foot, walking around, getting to know all these people on the streets, engaging in weird, interesting, wacky side quests, doing mini games, spending money in all the highly detailed shops. I'd say besides the combat, all of this stuff, the experiences in this world, you know, engaging in this culture and just having fun in weird, unconventional ways is why these games are so special. And Yakuza Like a Dragon definitely understands that. So yes, we recommend this game, but we also recommend the whole series. If you haven't checked it out already, like, what are you doing? Next over at number 7, we have Immortals Fenyx Rising, which I gotta say is probably one of the more overlooked games of the year, and it's probably one of the stronger Ubisoft games they've offered up in a while. And that's because essentially what they did here was make very much a Breath of the Wild inspired game, but mashing it with some elements they learned from making Assassin's Creed Odyssey. So you're thrown in this massive cartoony world of Greek mythology where you fight enemies, discover puzzles, go in dungeons, and climb up stuff and fight big monsters and all that. It's so satisfying because of the way it rewards your progression. Everything you do, if you discover like a hidden nook or cranny or solve an environmental puzzle in the world, all of it goes directly towards improving your character in satisfying ways, from loot or just resources and stuff to upgrade yourself. So I won't say that like if you're sick of open world games, this is gonna cure your sickness by any means, but still, the way it's all built, it's incredibly satisfying, especially because the world is also very big and very pretty. All the areas are very distinct, and it's fun to just glide around them with your wings, or ride on horseback or on a mount, or just run around and kill stuff. Either way, we found it incredibly satisfying and a big surprise for the year, and maybe you should check it out. Because over at number six, if we're talking about Ubisoft games, we gotta mention Watch Dogs Legion, which is also open world, and it plops you into a near future London. And it's the best part of the game. While I wasn't personally too hot on the gameplay itself, I liked exploring this London. The way they built it is incredibly convincing, especially with how they do the near future surveillance and tech riddled world. It almost kind of feels like a precursor to a real cyberpunk world, and it's cool to check out. Especially if you've got a good PC, this thing might bring your PC to its knees, but it's worth checking out because it can be absolutely gorgeous at times. Now, while you might not fall in love with the characters or some of the gameplay elements, doing open world shenanigans and just bopping around in London can be pretty satisfying if you give it a chance. Especially because they do a lot of interesting things here with elevation and the way vehicles work, it's pretty clever in spots. Next, over at number five, we have kind of a stark contrast with Ghosts of Tsushima, which takes open world gameplay elements that we've seen in a million games, but just makes them feel a bit more simple and more moment to moment, more meaningful. Everything you do in this open world Japanese island, everything you discover, any side quests you waste your time on, doesn't really feel like time wasted or anything like that. It all feels directly meaningful to either the story and developing the world and Jin, the main character, or improving your character, like getting maybe a cool new katana or some very important resources. But it's done in a very natural way with how the game organically guides you from place to place with visual cues on screen, so you're not constantly accessing the minimap, and it's not overblown with a bunch of clutter. Not to mention like the combat and the story just make it a fantastic game all around, but the actual world is beautiful and fun and worthwhile to explore, and that's important. Now, next over at number four, we have Cyberpunk 2077, the big open world game of the year, which has had some issues. We've talked about it to death. I think everybody has. Cyberpunk has a lot of bugs and glitches and design flaws that make it a little tricky for everybody to enjoy. But we think beneath all of its problems and its shortcomings, there is still a pretty decent, solid game there. And at the top of that is probably Night City itself, this big, massive Californian cyberpunk city set in the future is visually just unlike anything you've ever seen. Yes, there are some things that need to be worked out. The NPCs are brainless. The car traffic is absolutely mindless. You may get stuck in a building or you might fall through the ground because of all the glitches and bugs. But if you are truly looking for immersion, you put on that cool music, you explore this world at night with the cool neon lights, if you have a decent PC or a next-gen console, there is something special there. And we're talking about the open world game, so we're gonna highlight the open world of Cyberpunk here. It can be pretty cool. There are a lot of hidden little things to discover, weird characters to see, and just RPG style stuff to engage in. Is it the game to end all games? The game it was really hyped up to be? Maybe not, but Night City is pretty sweet, and it lives up to what was developed in the tabletop game that this game is actually based on. Next at number three, we have Spider-Man, Miles Morales, which many people will chalk up as just glorified DLC, but for me personally, I felt like I got my money's worth. We all did here at GameRanks. And part of that is because exploring the world is just as fun as it was with the original Spider-Man PS4 game, because you can't beat swinging around. It's just so much fun. It's more fun to get around web swinging than it is driving a car in any other open world game. So even if you're just going to do another random meaningless side quest, the fact that you're swinging and jumping and flipping and wall running to get there is awesome. But I'm not discounting the game. Spider-Man Miles Morales does take steps to make the side quests interesting and meaningful to what is going on and to developing and building out the world around Miles, and it works. Plus, it's worth pointing out that the world is beautiful. It features different times of day, different weather patterns, if depending on what you load in, and it's set around Christmas time in New York City, which is one of the most magical places in the world. We're absolutely completely biased being from here, but a Spider-Man game in the snow around Christmas time with all the famous landmarks, with all the bows, all the Christmas lights, they just really nailed that, and it's cool. It's worth experiencing, dude. Now down to number two, we have Assassin's Creed Valhalla, which is another big old Ubisoft open world game, but the near ancient setting of London is very cool, and it's very fun to explore it as a Viking, cruising around the environment on your boat through these rivers, hopping off your boat, raiding and pillaging, or just doing regular old Assassin's Creed exploration can be very satisfying. There's still a lot of things to accomplish here. There are tons and tons of things riddling the map to keep you busy. But it's worth pointing out that some of those side quests you'll stumble upon, some of those characters you stumble upon, are really, really interesting and really out there. I think this Assassin's Creed game, more than any other in the past, was allowed to just go totally buck wild with the side objectives and try wacky experimental stuff and just weird story concepts. That, more than anything, for me, made this game memorable. While in some ways it just felt like another one of these games, the random things they make you do out in this massive open world can sometimes be pretty cool and very entertaining. Now down to number one, if we're talking open world games of 2020, we're gonna go for the unconventional pick for number one, but it should actually be the most obvious. It's Microsoft's Flight Simulator, because it has like basically the whole world. This open world game uses real world data streaming in, weather patterns, map data, to give you the experience of flying anywhere in the world. And it is absolutely incredible and downright a sight to behold. What they built here is incredibly impressive, even if you want to put on a more casual setting and just fly around easily and not really engage in the more hardcore simulation stuff. It's kind of like experiencing Google Maps for the first time, all over again. Remember when you first discovered Google Maps and you were like, hey, let's look up my house, or hey, let's look up my school. Basically, now you're doing this in an airplane in three dimensions, and it's pretty dope. Especially with the way they do it, with the way it's designed, with all the effects, the real world wind physics, the detail on the ground level, it all really sells it and makes it feel engaging and like you're actually experiencing a world. Especially in 2020, a year where a lot of us were locked up in our homes, this was a fun way to go sightseeing. Full stop. Those are some of the best open world games from 2020, but we got some bonus games we also want to mention. First of all, Dragon Ball Z Kakarot, which released early 2020. A lot of people forget that, but that let you fly around as Dragon Ball characters in big environments. No Man's Sky Origins also deserves some love, because No Man's Sky has become an incredible open world galaxy space game thing over these years. And also, Need for Speed Hot Pursuit Remastered released this year, which kind of puts you in an open world driving location. Crysis Remastered also released this year and plopped you in a big open tropical island setting, and the indie darling Cloudpunk. These are some of the best open world games from 2020, but we'd love to hear yours down in the comments. If you have your own top 5 or your own top 10, be sure to let us know. If you enjoyed this video though, maybe had a good time or learned about something, clicking the like button is the best way you can help us out. We would really appreciate that. And if you're new, consider subscribing, maybe hitting that notification bell, because we put out videos every single day. Either way though, thanks for watching, and we'll see you guys next time.